The Frito Bandito was a cartoon mascot created by Frito-Lay for their corn chips in a campaign in 1967. The Bandito was a caricature of a Mexican man that spoke with this exaggerated Mexican accent, and it perpetuated negative stereotypes about Mexicanos y Latinidad. And it perpetuated this, and I'll share with you here in just a little bit this video. But in this advertising campaign, which ran from 1967 to 71, it was featured in print and television ads, and it encouraged consumers to buy two bags of Fritos, one for themselves and one for the Bandito. And let's take a closer look at that.
Hello, senor. I am the Frito Bandito. Oh, don't be afraid. I am not going to steal your Fritos corn chips. I buy them from you, okay? See, I give you silver. No silver? Okay, I give you gold. You don't like gold neither? Maybe you like better some lead, huh?
Citizens, protect yourselves. Never buy one bag of crunchy Fritos corn chips. Always buy two and hide one for you. Who knows? There may be a Frito Bandito in your house.
Appalling, right? Yeah, the Bandito's jingle was also sung to the melody of the traditional Mexican song, Cielito Lindo, further perpetuating the commercialization of Latinx heritage for profit. The character was immensely popular by Frito-Lay standards, but it also received complaints about its racist and stereotypical portrayal of Mexicanos and Mexican bandits, which was a common trope in popular culture at the time. Activist groups such as Dr. Hector P. Garcia with the American GI Forum, Nosotros and the National Mexican American Anti-Defamation Committee and other organizations protested these harmful depictions and urged for ending the use of racist and harmful stereotypes in advertisements such as this. Although Frito-Lay refused to stop using the character initially, as you'll see in this letter here to Dr. Garcia, the pressure from these groups and others led to the discontinuation of the Frito Bandito in 1971. Negative stereotypes of Mexicanos as bandits are still perpetuated in our historical documentation, even in contemporary times. For instance, the 1910 Hidalgo County Jail in Edinburgh, Texas, came before the Texas State Board of Review, of which I am a member, and this was just 2 years ago. And it came up for listing in the National Register of Historic Places. According to the nomination form, newspapers at the time recorded Deputy Sheriff Perez and Texas Rangers booking quasi-military groups of Tejanos who were characterized as Mexican bandits. This portrayal reinforces these historical, harmful stereotypes of Mexican people as violent criminals, and it perpetuates the negative perceptions of our culture today. So in response, I urge for the removal of the tropes to help promote a more accurate depiction of Mexicans and Latinx people. With the commercialization of our own heritage, it's important for us to exercise critical thinking while producing and consuming content to promote a more precise and comprehension of our living cultural heritage, especially as we're working to decolonize Cinco de Mayo. So thank you for your time. I've left my email here in case you have any questions. And with that, I will pass this on to Leo, LHC's education fellow. Gracias.
Okay, thank you for your patience. Okay, so for my presentation, and I'm quickly going to introduce myself again. My name is Leo Rodriguez. I'm an educator fellow for Latinos in Heritage Conservation, and I'm also a full-time student and graduate teaching assistant at the University of Texas Rio Grande Valley. So today we're going to speak about decolonizing Cinco de Mayo and how it's more than just guacamole. So for the agenda, first I'm going to go over Cinco de Mayo, what does it mean to you? And then we'll go into how it's a U.S. celebration. It's an American celebration. Why does the U.S. celebrate it more than Mexico does? See if there's any stats behind that. And then we're going to go into the history. What is the history behind Cinco de Mayo? We're going to do a quick glance at the history. Next up, we have the deliveries. I was a teacher for 6 years at the high school level. So I do have some experience with different types of deliveries. I've been a tour guide for a museum. I've been an intern at a museum as well, where I had to do different types of delivery. So I want to share some of that with you. And in addition to that, I was given the opportunity to teach at the university, an undergrad class dealing with Mexican American studies and decolonizing and reclaiming our identities. So I have some deliveries that might be interesting to you. And then at the end, I'll leave it up for questions. And those questions can be about anything. I know it says follow up on lesson deliveries. So if you have questions specifically about how to deliver a lesson or how to better deliver this lesson for your space or classroom, you can always shoot me an email that I'll share towards the end of this presentation, and I'll gladly follow up with you. So what does Cinco de Mayo mean to you? For here, I would love for you to use the chat. And if you can just answer, what does Cinco de Mayo mean to you? I'll put like 60 seconds on the clock. And if you can quickly answer, and then I'll piggyback off of some of those responses. So what does Cinco de Mayo mean to you? The chat is disabled. Can you answer it in the question and answer, since that's what I can see? Sorry about that. If you can please answer it on the Q&A section. What does Cinco de Mayo mean to you? Thank you, Madeline and Brent, for that. Okay, I have some good ones. Irasema, the holiday I ended up having to explain. Brent, so far, just a day to drink margaritas. It's fair. I mean, that's what we're advertised. And to be honest, and it was a trick question because I did include the avocado, the dip, the chips, the tomatoes. So yeah, you're right. We can see it as a day to drink margaritas. Or like Irasema says, the holiday I ended up having to explain. Okay. Let's see. I see some more. Another day when racist stereotypes are celebrated and justified with beer. Okay. It means celebrating my Poblana heritage. I like that. Somebody already mentioning Puebla. Okay. So let's see. What does Cinco de Mayo mean to you? What does it mean to the U.S.? It's a celebration. But why does the United States celebrate Cinco de Mayo more than Mexico does? Okay. And maybe this is where Irasema's comment comes in, where this is where I have to explain at dinner, you know. So why is it a U.S. celebration? Well, $700 million are generated from alcohol sales, okay, just on this day. And $350 million are generated from avocado sales to make the famous guacamole dip. So is the U.S. celebrating the history, or is there a market opportunity here that we're also seeing? So I'm going to give you a quick history, and something to keep in mind is that this is the history at a glance. After my presentation, Pedro's going to give a more detailed presentation on the history and a little bit more detail about the rise of the military culture in Mexico. What I'm going to go over more is how the Battle of Puebla was a key role in the American Civil War. So a glance at the history. The first step, the Battle of Puebla of 1862. At the time, Mexico owed France a lot of money. So the French troops came to Mexico with the idea of collecting their debt by conquering Mexico. And something to keep in mind is that the battle occurred parallel to the American Civil War that was happening in the States during 1861 to 1865. So the French strategy was to conquer Mexico and then supply the Confederacy with guns to win their civil war. In essence, they would weaken the United States enough to be later conquered by Napoleon III and the French. However, Mexico's army, led by General Ignacio Zaragoza, derailed the plans for a French North American colony. The French were forced to retreat, to recover, and would take a year-long delay to come back to conquer Puebla on May 1863. At this point, 2 years had already occurred in the American Civil War. So without the extra aid from the French, Abraham Lincoln had enough time to establish key victories during the American Civil War that could have otherwise have been defeats. And this is something that it's very at a glance, like I mentioned, and something that Pedro in the next presentation is going to take it a step further. But I do want you to get that glance at it about the history, because we hear a lot about Cinco de Mayo, but we don't even know the glance at the history. So what are lesson plan deliveries that we can go that we can utilize based off that? Lesson plans on Cinco de Mayo and how to deliver it for different spaces. Before the word spaces, I had the word classes on there or classrooms. However, I understand that not every teaching setting has to be a room, has to be a classroom. There's different spaces, like at a community event, or for example, at a museum. That's another example. So Latinos in Heritage Conservation Lesson Plan Deliveries. So I'm going to briefly touch on the lesson plan. And by the way, Latinos in Heritage Conservation provides access to the Cinco de Mayo lesson plan and more. In the follow-up email that you will be receiving, you will get all the links that were mentioned or used from this presentation, including the lesson plan. And if you can please subscribe to our newsletter for updates on new deliverables. So that's my first example. This link at the bottom will be emailed to you in that follow-up email. So let's take a closer look at the lesson plan before we look at different types of deliveries. So the very first part, this is designated for a 50-minute lesson plan. And it's created this template is very flexible. So you can use it in different methods in your space. So first of all, for 5 minutes, that quick do now, why do we celebrate Cinco de Mayo? That same way that I asked you in that slide, why do we celebrate Cinco de Mayo? And you answered, a quick 5 minutes, just take that little temperature check from your students to see where they're at or your audience. And then second, you want to go into introduction to new material. So this is, I would say, 15 minutes of teaching them the introduction. If you're teaching smaller students, I would not recommend using data dealing with alcohol, but that avocado cell data, that 350 million data, you can definitely share that. And this is where you want to engage them. Right away, Cinco de Mayo is not Mexican Independence Day. That's a whole other conversation. 16 de septiembre. But you want to get them with that, because a lot of students, they grow up thinking, oh, Cinco de Mayo, it's a celebration. Must be Mexican Independence Day. So this is something that you want to kind of use like that hook sentence or that hook activity to really introduce that new material. And then three, we go into the group discussion. I allocated another 15 minutes. This is what can look different for you, depending on your classroom. You can post it on the board. It can literally be projected with a projector. You can also have it on your whiteboard. You can also use sticky notes. But you can have the students answer this in whatever format works better for you. Questions that I put. What factors could have been key in the French defeat in 1862? Why do you think the French troops took a whole year to regroup and come back to conquer Puebla a whole year later? And how would the French benefit from conquering Mexico on their long-term plans of conquering the United States? So these are questions that are definitely meant to instigate critical thinking. And you can have the students either working on this individually or working it as a group, like it says, our group discussion. Now, when you bring them back to the class discussion, this is where you have time to explain and correct any misunderstandings, get to hear the students out. You definitely want to include that the year-long layoff that the French took after the defeat to the underdog Mexican army, it allowed Abraham Lincoln time to establish key victories during the American Civil War that could have otherwise been defeats if the French would have successfully supplied the Confederacy with either weapons, ammunition, or other financial resources. With over 37 million Latinx living in the United States, Spanish is the unofficial second language. If Napoleon III got his way, what would be the language we would be speaking today? And I actually taught today in my class, and I brought this question up to my students. How would it look today? How would our language look today? Would French be our first language, our second language? Would it be Mexico's first language or their second language? How would that look today? And then the exit ticket. You want to go ahead and gauge their understanding of the lesson while also using keywords like, who was a French leader trying to conquer Mexico on Cinco de Mayo? How did General Ignacio Zaragoza's army play a significant role in helping Abraham Lincoln defeat the Confederacy during the American Civil War? So again, these are exit tickets that you can use to gauge the understanding that the students received from the new material that you taught them. And now we're going to look at delivery options. So the first one, it's a sticky note. Straight to the point, what I like about sticky notes is that it ensures accountability for each student. Each student must turn in a sticky note. Each student must have their name written on their sticky note. So you know that every student has to turn one in. Even if they're in groups, you can still assign for them to individually answer on their sticky notes before they go and place it on the board. So this is something that they can even do in groups. And I like that idea because let's say they're confused a little on the assignment, then they can look at their peers and see what they're doing. I guess we can say no answer should look the same, but when it's something like this, when it's something that's a new material that's being learned, chances are that some answers will look the same, and that's okay. Another thing that you can do is you can do a virtual museum using padlet.com. It's a website. It's free to use. And you can create a virtual museum. Again, that's padlet.com. And you can have the students create, for example, evidence of Cinco de Mayo being used for a for-profit agenda or something like that. And they can go around the city, if that's an option, go around taking pictures, for example, of Cinco de Mayo specials and things like that. And then they can bring it back to Padlet and make a virtual museum out of it. Something that you can get really creative for a more creative approach or for older age groups, a zine creation. And I've done this where students can create either a digital zine, where again, it makes it easier for them. Templates will be there. It's more of a drag and drop, and they come up with the content, not necessarily the graphic. So that makes it easy. That would be a soft copy. You can also make them do a hard copy or a physical zine, which is something that I've done myself too for a class. And it's easy. And like I said, I guess it's easier said than done. So I will include links for zine creations in that follow-up email. So look out for those zine creation links, both physical and the digital version. Okay, so social media, that's another delivery option. You can create a class Instagram and have students create infographics to post. I recommend Canva in my classroom, and I've done this with 9th grade students in high school, 11th grade students, and also my freshman college students in my undergrad class. Canva is free. It's user-friendly. The templates are there. The graphics are there. You can have them create infographics that they can then go and share on their social media or on the class Instagram. That way your work can also be shared. If your campus or your organization already has an Instagram, maybe this is something cool that you can kind of like show off your students, show off what you've been working on. This would be a great medium for that. Storytelling. So you can create a class YouTube, similar to class Instagram, but creating a class YouTube to upload testimonials on their new learned material. So after you teach your class, maybe you don't want that to be the end of it. Maybe you want the students to reflect on it and come back with a story to tell. What does Cinco de Mayo mean to you? What does it mean to you now? Is there any history in your family dealing with Cinco de Mayo? Like Iracema says, was there ever like a difficult conversation? Students might already be having these conversations at the dinner table. So give them that opportunity, give them that platform to storytell and give their own testimonial. It's something that students are not used to, like sharing their voice and making them feel like their voice matters. That's also very, very important. So this is another tool you can use, storytelling. this one might be a little harder for you to do. However, for those of you that are working in the community, you can ask your local city manager for a space to create a mural to bring proper representation to your community. In this case right here that you see on the right hand side, that was at a local park locally where I live. And they went around as they wanted to basically represent campesinos, the farm worker movement at this park with this mural. But one thing they did is the class didn't just go and paint what they thought represented the farm workers. They went around asking farm workers, what do you want to see on that mural that's going to be dedicated to you? Now, they didn't just want to see their hard work represented on there, their labor. They didn't want to see the hot sun just shining on them, on their backs. They also wanted to see, they wanted to see themselves on that mural, their end goal or their dream at the end of the day, their motivation for keeping them going in those fields. And that motivation on the top left-hand side, you can see their children. Their children are graduating. They're graduating from college. And that's what keeps them going. And that's what tells them that it was all worth it. So a mural can really paint a story and a strong story. And they're there to stay for the community to see and appreciate. And then this is another one. My students actually created this. And this is a 3D printed lamp, and this can be used in different formats. On the right-hand side are the actual lamps. And each lamp has 7 layers of paper. So the students have 7 layers that they have to cut to create this 3D model. In the back of the papers, there's a light. And when that light is turned on, it gives it like that shadow effect. Fun fact, we ordered these boxes from Hong Kong and it only took about maybe a week and a half or two to get them. The students got to work. They designed it on Procreate on an iPad. and I'll explain right now where they got the inspiration to create what they did. But basically what you see here is a reimagination of what our borderlands look like here in the Rio Grande Valley. We're a region that's still growing. So for example, I'll explain this box right here. This box on the right-hand side, it's supposed to explain SpaceX. We see a satellite here. SpaceX is in our backyard here in the RGV. And while everyone thinks like, oh, SpaceX, great, STEM, you know, that's a highlight to your area. That's great. However, there are things that come with it. There are consequences that come with SpaceX being here. And that's what the students wanted to represent. And I'll quickly share this video that takes a closer look at it and how it looks live. So that's a church, a local church that we have here. That's the development box, SpaceX, the abuelas, the nopales that we have here, and the farm workers. So these 3D printed lamps, they're very popular at the symposium that we did. And that's what we did. We held it at a symposium, which is another form of delivery that you can use. Right here, you can see that this is the original map that the students were taught in class. This map was given to us it illustrates the valley 100 years ago. And it was very similar to Cinco de Mayo. There's a big misrepresentation from it. So the students are like, hey, let's decolonize that. Let's take that map and recreate it in our own way. And that's what we're going to present. And that's what they did. So with the Cinco de Mayo, you can also do that. You can create a symposium at your local university. You can create a symposium at your school, whether it's in the hallways, in the library, or even at your local museum, or somewhere in the community space where you're allowed. You can definitely create some sort of symposium relating to Cinco de Mayo. So that wraps up my presentation. So I'm just here to tell you that when life gives you avocados, let's preserve history. And if you have any questions as far as the delivery, the lesson plan, how to make it better fit to your space, please save my email and shoot me an email and I'll respond to you. Okay. Thank you. And now I'm going to go ahead and give my host privileges back to Pedro, I believe.
Yeah, thank you so much. And whoa, that lamp idea, that's super cool. So yeah, everybody, hey again, Pedro here with public lands advocates here with Green Latinos. Let me just make sure I can turn on my camera. I'm back. And so yeah, I wanted to now pivot, and again, just thank you so much already to Sehila and Leo for these discussions so far. And so what I wanted to do now is kind of do as deep of a dive as possible within 20 minutes on some of the more nuanced part of Cinco de Mayo and a little diving more into the history and again, the significance, which I would argue is Cinco de Mayo is relevant to the broader history of North America and the Western Hemisphere. And so in the 20 minutes, I'm going to try to make my case, but I will just take a quick second to share my screen with everyone as well, too. And so again, just to orient some of the folks who were not on earlier, my formal training is a historian. And a historian of Latin American history through the University of California at Berkeley. And so if you would have told me I'd be presenting on some of my senior thesis a couple years ago, I probably wouldn't believe. But I think something that I'll be using for my presentation is there's lots of artwork. And for me, as well, through one of my many other lives outside of activism and the political space, is that I am an artist as well, too. And so one of the broader relevance I will just share with you now up front, because I'll be using several pieces in this presentation, is how Mexican artists and Mexican art, particularly through the lens of telling history, catapulted Mexico into worldwide relevance and importance in the global art scene as well, too. And so some people call it the Mexican Renaissance, but more broadly, murals and imagery was used to educate the population that at that time was had very, very low literacy levels. And so just using that context, but also the goal to educate folks as well too, that produced so much good Mexican art, which I'll be using to demonstrate some of the concepts and trends I'm gonna be presenting to you about. Again, I wanted to maybe take a step back and to situate Cinco de Mayo in several centuries of warfare. And for me, and for like our team at Green Latinos, a question, very legitimate question came up of like, what does it mean when Cinco de Mayo, on top of the other concepts like independence and self-determination and fighting for liberation, is also an armed conflict? I think that speaks a lot to the broader contours of Mexican history, particularly since European colonization. Starting, at least for this timeline's sake, 1521 with the fall of the Northern Land, Spanish conquest. Nearly 300 years later, the Mexican War for Independence was a decade-long effort, as well to initiated by Father Miguel Hidalgo, who's actually right here the central figure. Immediately after the war with Spain had concluded, Spain attempted to reconquer Mexico again. And only after 8 years after the formal, the first war for independence over, Spain recognized Mexican independence. But flash forward another 10 years, you have what's called the French Pastry War. And so I wanted to bring this up because situating this French reconquest attempt to reconquer footholds in North America after they lost the foothold in Louisiana, in modern United States. And so the French were an imperial country, colonizing places like Africa and most certainly North America as well, too, just like Great Britain, Spain, and Portugal. And so that was a very short-lived conflict. Flash forward another 10 years. It's kind of like Mexican history is really neatly compacted in decades at a time. But flash forward another 10 years where you have the U.S.-Mexican War, where after fighting off the French and the Spanish, the United States conquers roughly half of the territory of Mexico, incorporating the states roughly from Texas to California. In that time as well, too, you have multiple civil wars occurring in Mexico, ranging over conflicts like what type of religion should be incorporated in government, if at all, discussing economic developments or how land should be managed, which is the Guerra de la Reforma. And immediately interjecting this civil war is this 6-7 year French invasion. And so I'll pause there just to really highlight the fact that, you know, while Cinco de Mayo and the Batalla de Puebla is not Mexican Independence Day, it is certainly related to the larger effort of Mexico gaining its independence and keeping it as well, too. And then I'll be concluding, this is a little bit of a teaser for some of the significance, but right after the French invasion, you have what Mexican scholars call the Porfiriato, which is a nearly four-decade dictatorship, military dictatorship, which set up the context for the Mexican Revolution. So again, Mexican history is very, I guess, violent in terms of concentrated warfare. And again, I think when we think of things like gun violence in Mexico and the United States as well, too, it's really important to ground it in this larger contour of history. And again, I started this half of the presentation very text heavy. I'm breaking some presenter rules here, but I wanted to at least convey as clearly and concisely as possible some of the other big themes, right? Because I think, as I mentioned when we started this presentation, one of the goals is to push back against this oversimplification of Mexican history, right? It's not Cinco de Drinco. And so one of the first bullet points I really want to emphasize here is this is regardless of whose side was winning or fighting, the unifying theme was self-determination, right? Is when we reclaim a country back from European colonizers, and what do we do with this country, right? And one of the foundational challenges of Mexican history and nation building was the multiple wars, because it created more debt, it reduced the population, it sowed internal divisions as well, too, that still exist in the country. So I think in terms of significance, it did reinforce the military rule, but also helped reinforce military presence in political affairs, like independence and governing. Also, moving to the second point, for the interest of time, Cinco de Mayo, we celebrate as one day, but as actually a two-month campaign to seize Puebla in an effort to cut off trade routes to Mexico City. And eventually, Puebla was taken by the French. And eventually, Mexico City was also taken by the French as well, too. And so beyond the singular date, this is part of a larger campaign that also, you know, we say Puebla, but there was also urban warfare and guerrilla warfare as well, too. And so just really to decentralize, like, what actually was happening and where it happened. I mentioned earlier that the French had tried to invade Mexico in the late 1830s. And so the French blockaded trade and also bombarded Veracruz. You know, heading into a little bit of a pivot on some of the culture, right, of around this colonization. I think it's safe to say that while in the process of colonization, there were certainly European elements of culture and race that were woven into Mexican society. But even at that point in time, the French were still relying very heavily on racial and cultural superiority. And that was a foundational pillar to justify their own invasion. And no different than the Spanish, where essentially they said that and felt that the Mexicans were not fit to self-govern, or were and explained the some of the poverty or lack of a built nation as a result of inherent inferiority rather than a product of centuries of warfare and exploitation. And that said, I'll just jump to the last point, which I kind of talked about, because I kind of mentioned the Puebla campaign was urban and guerrilla warfare, was that even though racial superiority was a foundational pillar to this colonizing effort, there was still cracks in that concept. For example, the yellow fever that was decimating the French soldiers created a need for military presence. And so what that meant was that there was forced conscription of African soldiers who were believed, or African people that were made soldiers, because they were believed to be more resilient to yellow fever. And also, I think to complicate things even further, indigenous people and communities were allowed to join the French ranks. And so I think I really wanted to mention that because indigenous communities were not a monolith. At that point in time, as I mentioned, Mexico as a country was struggling and often, you know, exploiting or further oppressing the indigenous communities that reside in what we now know as modern Mexico. And so there was plenty of reasons in that line of thought to join someone else to potentially have a different and potentially better future. So again, and also on top of this, the African soldiers and the indigenous soldiers, well, there were folks from throughout Latin America that joined the French military. And so even in that composition of the military body, this was an international effort as well, which I think really speaks to how globally connected, even in the 1800s, the world really was. And so just to pivot, because honestly, each one of these things could be its own hour-long discussion, I want to discuss very briefly some of the long-term historical significance. And so, as Leo mentioned earlier, this shifted the trajectory of the U.S. Civil War. The Confederacy, and this is particularly pointed in my mind because I stayed the night in Texas yesterday, but the Confederacy and states like Texas traded with Mexican states like Nuevo León, which are on the northern border, who were also sympathetic with the French. And so while we think U.S. Civil War is happening there and the civil wars in Mexico are keeping everyone busy, there's still that extra international development, right? And so in that way, this had really significant potential for international relations because the borderlands, you know, historically were viewed as a place of contention, right, of where the United States and states that became the Confederacy stole parts of Mexico and, you know, were actively racist to Mexicans that resided north of the border. But at the time, there was this really peculiar partnership. And so this map is actually from my senior thesis. I found it in the archives when I was studying in Austin, of where the Confederacy identified multiple major cities along the Rio Bravo, where they would float cotton and call it Mexican cotton and use that kind of like drug smuggling, but cod smuggling, I guess, to bypass the naval blockade that the U.S. Union, was enforcing against the Confederacy. So they were smuggling this cotton, right? It was a major crop of the South in partnership, often with the French as well, too. And so there was lots of potential for the French to insert themselves in this really contentious geopolitical situation. And so just going to the second point, though, delays from the French defeat in the Batalla de Puebla prevented more coordination and support towards the Confederacy. So again, even the U.S. Civil War was a 4 to 5 year, depending on how long you count it, effort. And so it was not a clear-cut Union victory as well, too. And so you can view this as contributing to some of the sabotage of the Confederacy that reduced their financial resources, reduced their gun supplies, reduced their ability to obtain medicine and uniforms, really important things that were necessary for victory. Because at that point in time, the main cause of death in the U.S. Civil War was not actually through the warfare. It was through the infection that soldiers experienced at that time. And so it is the consensus among U.S. historians and even Mexican historians that if the French would have seized control of Mexico faster, then they would have allied themselves with the Confederacy and altered the course of the Civil War. And to that point, in history and narrative on U.S. history, it's very white supremacist insofar as only and mostly, even at this point in time, white people are viewed as the main actors in shaping important events. But at least I hope to show you, at least in this very little snippet, that Mexicans and Mexican history is important to global history as well. And it's particularly the United States, because after the United States has won, the Union led the effort to recreate the United States. And so you can view the U.S. Civil War as one of the last major disputes internally before the United States became the global superpower that it is now. Because a few decades after that, once the United States was in its reconstruction phase, then the United States embarked on various military operations against Latin America. They gained wealth and again just set up the foundation for the modern United States superpower. So as far as significance, I think that's pretty important. But I want to shift things back to Mexican history. And again, I think the main theme around self-determination and what you do with a country. As I mentioned earlier, Mexican history has decades and centuries and some centuries of military warfare being critical to important events, right? And so the Batalla de Puebla reinforced, again, the role of military culture. And why I think I'm really, really hitting this point on is because of this central figure. His name is Porfirio Díaz, and he was actually captured at the Batalla de Puebla. And through some twists of fate and crazy whatever happened, he was able to escape French captivity. And so after escaping French captivity, he played a very important role in the Mexican army in, as they defeated the French. And so, as I mentioned earlier, he rode this the political wave and the military wave into high prominence in Mexico. And so he became president and established a near 40-year dictatorship of military rule. And so it's really important, I think, just to widen up the scope of Mexican history. Because if we just only focus on the Batalla de Puebla or just the 7-year period of the French invasion, that's just a snapshot in the larger trend, right? And so this under this military dictatorship, civil rights were curtailed, like freedom of speech or freedom of the press, or ability to engage in politics, right, without significant consequences. And also, the economic development that occurred under this military rule created the or accentuated the massive wealth inequality in Mexico. And so, when you think of the Mexican Revolution that occurred from 1910 to 1921, again, a century after independence, which I wanted to mention, a century after independence, and this happened 100 years after winning this. And so, again, independence, in a way, has been delayed or sabotaged through these ongoing wars. And as I mentioned earlier, just with the artwork as well, they demonstrate, they show, this shows General Porfirio Diaz in the presidential palace surrounded by wealth, and surrounded by important decision makers as well, too, and the central figurehead. And they also have his foot, which I believe this is the Constitution of Mexico. So to demonstrate again that while independence was maintained by defeating the French, what happened with that independence is another question. And when you think of the Mexican Revolution, that's a really important phase in foundational, like, Mexico, Mexican history and Mexican society, because that was a way for people like Milo Zapata or Pancho Villa to organize their communities, and respectively in the North and South, to fight back against this wealth inequality and the injustice that Mexicans were experiencing. And so, as a result of the Mexican Revolution, there's pictures of Pancho Villa and Emilio Zapata in the presidential palace, because these rural oppressed Mexican citizens took over Mexico City, kind of similar in the same way that the French overtook it as well, too. And so, again, Mexico City is really important. Central piece. But again, I think what I'll maybe like wrap up here is that when you think of like Mexican history or Cinco de Mayo, right? Like the way it's oversimplified by just celebrating or, you know, drinking to things. When I think of this history, this does not make me inherently want to celebrate. I recognize the role of self-determination and community organizing and wanting a better future as part of my inheritance. But when I think, when I situate it in this way, I think I want a margarita maybe for the depression, not maybe less for the celebration. And so when I mentioned earlier, and I'm wrapping up here, is what this meant for Mexican art. And this was a way, again, Jorge Posada revolutionized printmaking through Mexican history. And so this is, you know, again, what Mexican history has looked like in its entirety. But this is by Diego Rivera. This is a huge mural in Mexico City. But as I mentioned earlier, like, this really revolutionized muralism where at the bottom you have the indigenous history, and you have the Spanish colonization. In the middle, you have Father Miguel Hidalgo and Vicente Fernandez, who was actually an Afro-Mexican president early on in the 1820s. And at the top, you have people like Emilio Zapata and Pancho Villa representing the Mexican Revolution as well, too. And so I think I wanted to end here because, like, this image is more all-encompassing for Mexican history. But when you think of just the Batalla de Puebla, it's really, again, only one episode in this larger trend. And when you see it like this, you can see the broader Mexican history reflected. And again, like, I think images like this push back against that oversimplification. And I think this is another image by Diego Rivera as well that just shows more into the future of how Mexico dealt with industrialization as well, too, in the 1940s, 1950s. But I at least hope that this can demonstrate in some degree that Cinco de Mayo is more than Cinco de Drinco. And again, I think there's a lot that myself, Sehila and Leo could have been talking about as well, too. But just in the interest of time, and I want to make sure that I'm getting to people's questions if there's any, or that I, if there's any other questions for Leo or Sehila, I'm going to stop sharing my screen right now, too. But I hope this was insightful. And again, I'll welcome any questions that folks might have for any of the panelists. So thank you.
I see that Ms. Rachel Polak has her hand up. I'm not sure if she has a question.
Yeah, Rachel, can you come off mute or enter your thought or question in the Q&A box? Okay, cool. So maybe I can kick things off. I have a question for maybe both Leo and Sehila, where definitely the both of you are very engaged in history, and I think also your engagement through Latinos in heritage conservation has very tangible results that, you know, like designating historical monuments or so on and so forth that engaging a classroom maybe might not have. And so I guess I'm wondering, what was some of your inspiration? Because I think it's a really interesting mix of education and activism and environmentalism and organizing and all those good things. So I guess, what were some of your inspirations around that?
Cool. So thank you, Pedro. And I can quickly share inspiration for decolonizing Cinco de Mayo. I taught at a high school for 6 years, and I saw what students were being taught and what wasn't being taught. And I felt like a lot of it is catering to an exam. At least myself in Texas, where we still have standardized exams, I felt like it was catered to an exam and not necessarily lesson plans catered to discovering our true identity or our heritage or our history. And I'll piggyback off this question that was just asked on the chat. It says, I was born in Mexico. I don't remember celebrating Cinco de Mayo. I came to the U.S. in 1985. When did Cinco de Mayo begin to be celebrated here, and where did it start? I think that's a valid question. Today, when I taught this this lesson in my class, I had a student tell me the exact same thing. He said, in fourth, fifth grade, I migrated to the United States. So I never heard about the history of Cinco de Mayo. And then in the United States, I missed all the history previous to fifth grade. So he was kind of like in a weird situation where he's like, I actually never heard of Cinco de Mayo either in Mexico or in the United States. And to be honest, looking back at Cinco de Mayo in the US at least, I feel like it has to do a lot with maybe like commercials, maybe like during, I know, for example, during the Super Bowl, a lot of commercials are shown around like chips, dip. And I know that's still like 3 months before the Cinco de Mayo. But if I had to pinpoint it, I had to have been something dealing with like commercials. But this is what motivates me. Like those types of comments, what motivates me are students who are looking for that history, that heritage.
Yeah, and thanks, Leo. I'll jump in and say, you know, just similar. I'm just kind of on a personal mission to decolonize the history that we're being fed. I grew up in Texas and, you know, just very much grew up not hearing my own history or, you know, just hearing these dominant narratives that I talked about so much. So for me, just the inspiration in doing this is really started out with trying to self-educate, you know, and me wanting to learn really about Cinco de Mayo as a first-gen student here. But the appropriation part just has always bothered me. I didn't know what that was really, you know, quite. So this was a really interesting exercise for me personally. And then in my undergrad, I was an art history major where I focused a lot on iconography and also just overlooked histories. And so I started doing a lot of research then around, you know, similar types of topics around Mexican history and how that commercialization has been, you know, just really has become like this hot commodity in the US. So yeah, it was a really fun exercise to do this. And for the work that we do, which is very place-based, we always carry this lens with us in trying to decolonize these narratives and trying to tell our own stories so that way other people aren't writing our own histories.
Absolutely. Yeah, I got actually some questions. That was just maybe both of you in passing can say what part of Texas you're from. That was one of the questions in the chat.
So I'm from the RGV, Rio Grande Valley, Edinburgh, Texas, Puro 956, just throwing that out there in case anyone's from the 956.
And I'm currently living in the Austin area in Central Texas, but I was born and raised in DFW in North Texas, Grapevine is my hometown, and then just recently was living in Houston for 6 years, so kind of been all over the state.
Very big state. I'll say my mom came from Texas as well, a town called Harlingen.
Oh.
And moved to California, so they said that they would pay more in the field out there. So I see another question in the chat. Do you feel it was Corona beer that started the Cinco de Drinko in the U.S.? That's an interesting one. I'll try. Where I gotta say, it's hard for me. I'm sure that someone's probably have written a book on this. I want to think like this is, I'll try to answer like a historian without knowing exactly the right truth. Is like, I would say. It's safer to say that companies like that, if not started, certainly reinforced it. as a marketing opportunity. And, you know, I think there's two currents to the Cinco de Trinco narrative, right? It's folks, a lot of like white-led or white-facing corporations that are catering to that idea, and then also like other corporations or companies that can benefit from the market activity that's generated around this time. You know, so I think maybe it's a complementary kind of web. For me, I think it's, but Corona is definitely one of the major like U.S. Mexican beers, and they certainly have that kind of that presence as well too. I have seen some other try to take on like a little more woke Cinco de Mayo like branding, like we don't appropriate, but like drink our beers anyway. so at least I could try to say that, answer that safely in that way. But Sehila or Leo, do you maybe have any thoughts on that?
I'll just jump in and say that is such a good question. And when I was prepping for this, I was going down a rabbit hole of research, and I don't know the answer to that, but I read a lot of articles that said like in the 90s and then in the early 2000s, this marketing campaign, people just started catching on, and for-profit businesses were really getting into this. It was like jarring to see how commercialized and how like produce is such a hot commodity around Cinco de Mayo and alcohol, as Leo shared with those dollar amounts, but how everybody like is in on this game to make as much money as they can. So I don't know exactly who it was, but I found a lot of literature around like the 90s and the 2000s. And I will say growing up, you know, I definitely remember, like y'all remember like the old beer commercials around Cinco de Mayo, and, you know, just very, very harmful narratives, and then also very sexist, you know, in just like the way that they marketed. So if anybody has an answer to that, I like put your answer in the chat, would love to learn more.
And we have maybe time for one or two more questions. If anyone has wants to ask anything particular to the comment or to the content or anything else to any one of our panelists as well. And so maybe I don't see any questions coming in, and I'll take maybe facilitators' initiative so I think we're almost at time. So maybe a question, because we went over like a lot of different themes, right? Leo talked about like education, how to communicate this, and how like demonstrate like comprehension that's in a relevant way. So I did a masterful job of talking about like the cultural appropriation. And I did okay too. But what's maybe one or two like big things? Like if people like go to the mall and run into the friend, like I saw a webinar, and this is what it's about. You know, what would you say are that should be the takeaways?
I think I just saw Claudia's hands raised. Claudia, do you want to share something?
I think Claudia mentioned in our Q&A box, any of you come to Corpus Christi Del Mar College?
I may be
going, that sounds like an experiment.
Yeah, I may be going to Corpus sometime this year, Claudia.
And I'll end our time with one more slide with our email. So Claudia, you can make sure to grab that email as well too. But I see Gloria as well too saying, I worked for County Health, and before COVID, this event, I'm assuming Cinco de Mayo, was huge for a lot of public outreach, sharing county resources with our communities as well too. And Claudia teaches at Del Mar College. Awesome. Let me just check this box anymore too. Okay, cool. Let me see, was there any more? Okay, cool. Well, yeah, thanks. Maybe before I wrap up, Sehila and Leo, any last words?
I just want to say a huge thank you, Pedro, to you and Green Latinos. This has been really exciting and fun, and I've learned so much through your presentation. It was fantastic and amazing, both of yours, and continue to be blown away how I'm like still learning more. But thanks so much for including LHC.
And for my part, thank you, Pedro and Green Latinos, and thank you, Sehila, for allowing me to be part of this. I'm always excited when it comes to anything decolonizing, anything reclaiming. I'm all down for it. So this was very fun. And I'm just going to touch back on a comment or a question by Gloria Gonzalez on the chat. It says, I work for County Health, and before COVID, this event was huge for a lot of public outreach and sharing county resources with our Latinx communities. And that's okay. We're not necessarily saying cancel Cinco de Mayo, but what we're saying is reclaim it, reclaim that history. Don't cancel the events, but maybe use that event. It's already a success. You're already getting participants. Now you can use that event as outreach to educate on the history and the heritage of Cinco de Mayo. So good point, Gloria.
Yeah. I mean, on that point too, I think this was fun because Cinco de Mayo just has such a presence in the popular like awareness, right? I would have loved to delve into a bunch of other obscure history things. I wore my history teacher blazer too. No, I could tell. But I mentioned earlier, this is actually the first kind of big event, at least for this year, that Green Latinos is going to be leading on for our Take Back Cinco de Mayo campaign. There's a couple of ways for folks to, you know, stay involved. Actually, for the week of Cinco de Mayo, so next week, conveniently May 1st through the 5th, our social media, Green Latino social media, is going to be having different days, different themed days leading up to the Cinco de Mayo as well too. So stay tuned for some of the content that we're going to be pushing out as well, different ways to celebrate. Also, we'll be circulating in our follow-up email to all the registrants as well, our Take Back Cinco de Mayo declaration as well too, which reiterates a lot of the same themes. And we're hoping to use that document in our efforts to work with the Biden administration and different Congress people to make this an important day for the rest of the country as well. And again, feel free to share the word, or at least, you know, continue to educate, because I think this is one of the best ways information travels. It's through networks, it's through people that we know and people that we trust as well. So thank you all for trusting Green Latinos, and for trusting Latinos and heritage conservation to, spend this last hour and a half with you talking about really fun history stuff. And I think I hope y'all had as much fun in this event as I had, or at least some degree. But I really appreciate it. We hope to do more partnerships between us, and, you know, just use history as a way to, you know, remember or reconnect with the ancestry or you know, communities that we might have never been taught about or have lost touch with. And so, again, thank you so much for your time. I hope you all have a good rest of your evening, wherever in the country you're based in. And again, keep an eye out for a follow-up email with recording resources, and we'll also share PDFs of our presentation as well for any of your, you know, personal uses. So thanks again, My name was Pedro Hernandez, and it was a pleasure, everyone. So please take care.